was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your
heaven,
the darling of heaven, crucified.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Thank you for the cross.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came, gave amazing grace.
Thank you for
this love, Lord. Yes, thank you.
Wash me in your cleansing blood.
Now all I know is your forgiveness and embrace.
Let's really bring it out. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Seated on the throne.
Seated on the throne. We crown you now.
High and lifted up,
Jesus, Son of God,
Jesus, Son of God,
the darling of heaven,
the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the
crown.
crucified.
We cry, worthy,
worthy is the Lamb.
Perfect and righteous, pure and holy.
Worthy is the Lamb.
You accepted. You fall on the third day.
We cry, oh,
worthy, 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 worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Suspended in space, and though he was blameless, they led him to die. Just to think of the cross moves me now. The nail in his hands, his bleeding brow. To think of the cross moves me now. It should have been me. It should have been me. Instead, I am free. I am He put an end to my guilt and despair, turned bitter hating to sweet peace and love. Even the men that put him up there were offered forgiveness and life from above. Just to think of the cross moves me now. The nails in his hands, his bleeding brow. To think of the cross moves me now. It should have been me. It should have been me. Instead, I am free.
When I think of the cross, it is because of that cross that I am free. But what kind of love could possibly make anyone endure what Jesus had to go through on that cross? Well, if you want to know someone's heart, observe that person's final journey. With his mission still before him, Jesus stopped his disciples and told them for the third time about his upcoming encounter with the enemy that would accomplish the plan of salvation. "We are going to Jerusalem," he said. "The Son of Man will be turned over to the leading priest and the teachers of the law, and they will say that he must die. They will give the Son of Man to the Roman authorities to laugh at him, to beat him with whips, and crucify him. But on the third day, he will be raised to life again." Amen? Forget any suggestion that Jesus was trapped. Erase any theory that Jesus did it reluctantly. Ignore any suspicion that the cross was a last-ditch attempt to salvage a dying mission. For if his words to the disciples tell us anything, they tell us that Jesus died on purpose. No surprise, no hesitation, and no faltering. The way Jesus marched to his death leaves no doubt. He had come to this earth for this very purpose, and now the time had had come. The moment was at hand. He, the spotless Lamb of God, was about to present himself as a sin offering, that he would thus bring to an end this system of types and ceremonies that for 4,000 years had pointed to his death. He committed to them the new covenant, by which all who received him became children of God and joint heirs with Christ. This covenant deed was to be ratified and sealed with his own blood. Amen.
How beautiful. and to become the Lamb of God. Your gift of love they crucified. They laughed and scorned him as he died. The humble king they named a fraud and sacrificed the Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Wash me in his precious blood. By Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. But you have brought me to your side to be led by your staff and rod and to become a Lamb of God. Oh, I love the holy, holy Lamb of God. Wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in his
with me a couple of points this morning in Christ's life. The first one being how Christ chose to surrender daily to his Father. The scriptures are full of accounts where he prayed to his Father daily. So my question to you is, if it was important for Christ to do that, how much more important is it for us? The second point is Christ's baptism. You see, when you and I take part in baptism, we're admitting that there's sin in our lives. And we go down in that water and we come up to a new life. All those things are behind us. But wait a minute. Christ was without sin. So why did he have to be baptized? You see, I think it was because it was a way for him to identify himself with sinners. A way for him to identify himself with you and I. Taking the steps that we are to take and doing the work that we must do, his life of daily surrender serves as a living example of what you and I must do to be victorious over sin.
Here are my hurts, here are my doubts, here are the things that I can't figure out. Here are my storms, my my crashing seas. Here are the burdens that have brought me to my knees. And I will take you at your unfailing word. More than all I want, I will seek you first. I will bless your name when the night is long. God, you have my surrender. Oh, God, you have my surrender. Here are my prayers. My heart will wait, and I will bow my will so you can have your way. Here are the things I can't undo. God, you have my surrender. I cast my cares on. I cast my cares on. I cast my cares on you. Yes, I cast my cares on. I cast my cares on. I cast my cares. Unfailing word, more than all I want, I will seek you first. I will bless your name when the night gets long. Lord, you have my surrender. Oh God, you have my surrender. God, you have.
Holy Spirit, take rest in me. Make me your temple. Restore my soul. My heart is your own. This I decree.
Restore my soul.
take rest. Oh, take rest. Rest. Oh, take rest. Oh, take rest.
Jesus did so many miracles during his ministry here on this earth that the Bible tells us that there is no way that the books would hold all the miracles that he performed. From giving sight to the blind, cleansing and healing lepers and those with many other diseases, helping the lame and the crippled to walk and stand up straight and tall, feeding thousands, speaking to the winds, calming the seas and raising the dead. For all those who believed in him, wounded hearts and sick souls were healed and given new life. Wherever Jesus went, something special happened, and those who followed him believed and knew that if they could only touch him, that they would be healed and made whole.
All I need is a touch from you. No one else can do the things you do. Lord, take my life and make it right. Oh, I need is a touch from you. Oh, I need is a touch from you. Lord, I'm standing in the need of prayer. When I call, Lord, Lord, I know you're there. Reach down from heaven and pull me through. All I need is a touch from you, Jesus. All I need is a touch from you. If you touch me, I'll change my lose to a win. If you touch me, I know I shall live again. Take my wrong and make it right. 'Cause all I need is a touch from you. Oh, I need is a touch from you. If you touch me, if you just touch me, I know I'll be made whole. Yes, I will, Jesus. If you just touch me with your finger of love, touch me. Anybody ever here been touched? Touch me. Oh, yeah, touch me. Like I know you can touch me. You can deliver me. Oh, you can heal me, Jesus. All I need is a touch from you. All I need is a touch from you. Oh, I need is a touch from you. Are my worship, you are my praise. With my whole heart, I will bless your name. No one compares, no one by far. You are my worship. That's what you are to me. Oh, to me. Thank you.
blessing to be found when we go back and read and reread the story of Christ's last night with us on earth. So this morning we want to take a verbal trip back to the garden. Read a little bit. It's just a snippet of what went on that night. But I would suggest you go back and read the whole story. Tremendous blessing waits for us there. Among the disciples, Peter, James, and John were his closest companions. In company with his disciples, the Savior made his way to the Garden of Gethsemane. As he neared the garden, it became strangely quiet. He had often visited this spot for meditation and prayer, but never with a heart so full of sorrow as upon this last night of his agony. Throughout his entire life on earth, he had walked in the light of God's presence. But now the guilt of fallen humanity he must bear alone. Upon him who knew no sin must be laid the iniquity of us all. So dreadful does that appear to him. So great is the weight of the guilt that he must bear, that he is tempted to fear it will shut his Father out from him forever. Feeling how terrible is the wrath of God against transgression, he exclaims, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death." As they approached the garden, the disciples had marked the change that came over their master. Never before had they seen him so utterly sad and so silent. As he proceeded, the strange sadness deepened, yet they dared not question him as to the cause. His form swayed as if he were about to fall. Every step he took now was with labored effort. He groaned aloud, as if suffering under the pressure of a terrible burden. Twice his companions supported him, or he would have fallen to the earth. He went a little distance from them and fell prostrate upon the ground. He felt that by sin he was being separated from his Father. The gulf was so broad, so black, so deep, that his spirit shuddered under it. As man, he must suffer the consequences of man's sin. As man, he must endure the wrath of God against transgression. Yet, in complete surrender to the will of the Father, he exclaimed, "Not my will, but thy will be done." Praise God. He made that decision for you and for me.
And oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still in waiting in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise
church say amen. Amen. Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
Have you been blessed already?
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to ask a dear friend of mine to come up and to bless us with a special selection. It's not in your program, but God does that for us. When we thought, when we think that he's given us enough blessings, he just throws in 10,000 more besides. Amen. Sister Sandra Mitchell is going to come, and she's going to share what God has placed upon her heart. Let's give her a hearty amen.
God has always stood by my side. He has always been guide. When my friends walk away and they turn back on me, he God has always stood by my side. Oh, yes, he has. He has always been my guide. When my friends walk away, sometimes they turn back on me. But he stood, and I thank you, Lord, right by my side. Let me say it one more time. Ooh, God has always stood by my side. Ooh, he has always been my guide.
Flowers in the fields.
I want you to, right now, just picture the scene. Because year after year, it gets more meaningful to me. About this time, an endless stream of pilgrims made their way into Jerusalem to offer up the lamb, the goat or the dove, as an atonement for their sin. Year after year, ever since the first sacrifice offered by Adam, blood had to be shed to point forward to the Lamb of God, the sin bearer, the one who would take upon himself all of the sins of the world from the beginning of time to the present time and for those in the future. And now, let's go up Golgotha's hill to Calvary. The creator of the universe is being executed. Spit from his tormentors and blood are caked to his cheeks as his lips are cracked and swollen. Every nerve in his body threatened to snap as unimaginable pain surged through his body. Thorns pierce into his scalp. His lungs scream out for breath in pain. His hands, those very hands that had carefully created and formed man from nothing more than clay, are now being ripped by the spikes that nail him to the tree. The cross is then dropped into a hole in the ground, and he must hang there. And death comes slowly. And there is no one to save him, for he is sacrificing himself. Far worse than the breaking of his body is the shredding of his heart. His own countrymen clamored for his death. One of his own disciples planted the kiss of betrayal. And one of his closest friends, the very one who had declared unfailing loyalty and devotion to him as the Messiah, denied that he ever even knew him. All of his disciples and followers ran for cover. Worst of all, his own father could not help him at this time. He had to suffer through this alone. There's no way that I could possibly ever understand why he would love me this much. There's nothing that I have ever done in my entire life that is so good that could begin to merit such a sacrifice as this. All I can say is thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Church, you should say thank you.
Thank you.
You see, I was the one who had committed the crime. I was the one who was guilty. That should have been me. That should have been me hanging on the cross. Instead, because of his sacrifice, if I accept him as my Lord and Savior, the Father looks at me and says, not guilty. I stand accused. There's a list of my law of all my sins and everything that I've done wrong. I'm so ashamed. There's nowhere for me to hide. This is the day that I must answer for my life. My fate is in the judge's hand. But then he turns to me and says, I know you, I love you, I gave my life to save you. Love paid the price for mercy. My verdict, not guilty. How can it be? I can't begin to comprehend what kind of grace would take the place of all my sin. I stand in awe that I have been set free, and the tears well up as I look at that cross, 'cause it should have been me. Yeah. My fate was in the nail-scarred hand. He stretched them out for me and said, I know you, I love you, I gave my life to save you. Love paid the price for mercy. My verdict, not guilty. I'm falling on my knees to thank you. With everything I am, I praise you. So grateful for the words I heard him say. I gave my life. I know you, I love you, I gave my life just to save you. Love paid the price for mercy. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature, in all created things, above all wisdom, in all the ways of man. You were here before the world began. Above all kingdom, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known. Above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you were.
crucified, lay behind the stone. You leave just to die, rejected and alone like a rose. You were trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Crucified, lay behind a stone. You leave just to die, rejected and alone like a rose. You were trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Like a rose, you were trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sins upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see our sins upon that cross. Can you help me sing this? Come on, say. Here I am to worship. Come on. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're all together love. You're all together wonderful to me. Here I am, words. Here I am. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful. to me.
You know, the story of the cross is more than a 2,000-year-old legend. It has meaning for us today. It has practical application. Amen?
Amen?
And I believe that our Father is actually disappointed in us when we place a low estimate on ourselves. I believe that He wants His children to value ourselves according to the price that He paid for us.
Amen.
You see, God loves each one of us. He wants each one of us. And if He had not, He would never have sent His Son on such an expensive rescue mission to redeem you and me.
Yeah.
Romans 8:32 puts it this way. God did not even spare His own Son, but offered Him up for us all. But it goes on and it says, how will He not also with Him grant us everything?
Yeah.
In other words, God so loved you and me that while we were yet in our sins, while we were enemies of God,
yeah,
while we were worthless, He sent His Son,
yeah,
to die for us.
Yes.
God gave His only begotten Son and sent Him to a cruel cross just so you and I could be saved. That story has practical application today. Amen? You see, I praise God that He saw something in us that we couldn't even see in ourselves. He thought we were worth saving. So from this moment forward, whenever the enemy tries to get inside your head and make you feel worthless, I want you to tell him, that's all right. He thought I was worth saving. When he tries to weigh you down with guilt and with shame from your past, you look at him and you tell that old devil, that's all right. I might have done those things, and I probably did a little bit more. But you know what? He thought I was worth saving. When he tries to mess with your finances and you find yourself struggling just to try to make ends meet, you need to look at that old devil and you need to tell him, you know what? He said that I'm going to be the head and not the tail. I'm going to be a lender and not a borrower. And beyond all that, he thought I was worth saving. When you go to the doctor and you get a bad report, and the doctor shakes his head and he wants to turn away because he feels like there's nothing else that he can do, you look at the devil and you rebuke him in the name of Jesus and you tell him, you know what? I'm standing on His promises. He said by His stripes I am healed. And you know what? He thought I was worth saving. You see, it doesn't matter what your situation is, because Easter Sunday is not about bunny rabbits and eggs and getting a new suit. It's not about that at all. You see, Easter is about God, the God of the universe, standing and declaring to the entire universe, they on that speck of dirt called Earth were worth saving. Your value is not determined by what you see in yourself. Your value is determined by what God was willing to pay for you. So in the eyes of God, you were worth every drop of blood that Jesus shed. He thought you and I were worth saving. Now the question is this: what are you going to do with it? God has done His part. What are you going to do?
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you clean me up you thought I was to die for. Oh, you thought I was to die for.
It has the power.
they tried to hide this precious blood. It gave me life.